ऑनरेबल डीन फैकल्टी ऑफ लॉ प्रोफेसर आर पी राय सर, रिस्पेक्टेड अली मेहदी सर, ऑल रिस्पेक्टेड टीचर्स ऑफ द फैकल्टी, एस्टीम कलीग्स एंड माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, इट्स गिव्स मी इमेंस प्लेजर टू वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू ऑन अवर न्यूली क्रिएटेड यूट्यूब चैनल. फ्रेंड्स, टूडे आई एम वेरी ग्लैड टू अनाउंस दैट अवर लॉ स्कूल BHU is going to start a lecture series on various contemporary issues relating to the law subject as well as the interdisciplinary subjects. Under the flag of prestigious current law forum of the law faculty BHU. Hence, we have intentionally started this lecture series from today because today is a very special day. Yes, friends, today is a World Environment Day, which is a renowned day for environmental action on global level. You all are aware that in 1972, the General Assembly of United Nations established the concept of World Environment Day on the first day of the Stockholm Conference, and after that, since 1974, it has been celebrated every year on the 5th June. As per United Nations, celebration of this day provides us with an opportunity to broaden the basis for the enlightened opinion and responsible conduct by single individual, by institutions, by society at large in preserving and enhancing the environment. Friends, it is undisputed that development and protection of the environment both are necessary not only for a smooth functioning of this world but also for its existence and survival. Due to this reality, a complete harmony between environment, civilization, development and economy becomes the need of the day. On the other hand, it is also a fact that we are regularly destroying the environment, sometimes for our basic necessities, but in most of the time for the purpose of either development or for the trade. We need not to go anywhere else to see those destructions. In our own locality and surroundings, we can easily see and observe the damages caused to the environment by human beings. Dear friends, I still remember in my childhood, near my house, there were more than 100 trees and a big pond. However, at present, most of the trees have been uprooted, and in the place of that pond, now a big multiplex building is there. This is the reality of our society, and due to which the environment we are living and breathing in is subsequently being deteriorated by us. I hope the celebration of this World Environment Day will give a message to rethink about the issue related with the environment. With these remarks, I very humbly invite Professor R.P. Rai sir, Head and Dean, Law Faculty, for his welcome address and presentation of the theme of today's lecture, which will be presented by Professor Ali Mehdi sir. Professor R.P. Rai sir.
Welcome, friends. First of all, I congratulate you all on World Environment Day. Friends, it is interesting to note that instead of personal interaction, we are joined through social media platform in this adverse time of coronavirus. As you are aware, the Faculty of Law, Banaras Hindu University, organizes lecture from time to time on contemporary issues under the auspices of current law forum. Today is World Environment Day, celebrated every year on 5th June. This day is United Nations Day for encouraging worldwide awareness and action to protect our environment. Each year, World Environment Day has a theme that major corporations, companies, NGOs and celebrities worldwide adopt to advocate environmental causes. The theme of this year is biodiversity, a call to action to stop the loss of species and degradation of naturals. It is a matter of pleasure that Professor Ali Mehdi, non-environmental expert, is with us. I welcome you, sir. As a chairman of current law forum, that you have very kindly agreed to share your experiences on this auspicious day. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor R.P. Rai sir. Now, I will invite Professor Ali Mehdi sir for his lecture.
Today is the 5th June. This 5th June is celebrated as Environment Day. This is because on 5th June 1972, United Nations organized UN Conference on Human Environment for the first time. And 5th June was the first day of this conference. This day is important just to recall those situations, those problems which were deliberated and discussed by the world leaders at an international forum. The environmental problem arises just from a very small area, and ultimately it gets accumulated and it make a spread over the across the boundaries, and ultimately a problem that has grown from one small place collectively affects the environment at the global level. And therefore the world leaders express deep concern over the increasing environmental problem, and particularly those environmental resources which were very, very essential for survival of the mankind, that is the water, air and some other mineral resources. So since then, the Environment Day is celebrated by all the civilized nations. The Environment Day sometimes is given some different theme, different themes, and particularly this 5th June 2020, this day has been given environment theme, celebrate biodiversity. The environmental concern is important, I feel, because here the individual, what is most essential for survival is the water and the air. Of course, the biodiversity comprises the different species, different kinds of animals, plants as well, all over the world, even under the water as well. But the resources which are very, very essential for survival are the air and the water. The Constitution of India, that is the supreme law of the land, initially has no such provision for the environment, though there were different entries like the mines, minerals, water, but these have a very remote effect on a very comprehensive legislation. Rather, the parliament has to glean the subject from here and there to make law for the protection of the environment. After this conference, in the year 1974, the Water Act was passed, and then in the year 81, Air Act was passed. In the year 1986, Environment Protection Act was passed, and very important, 2010, where the National Green Tribunal Act was passed. In addition to the legislations, in 1974, Constitution itself was amended, and by that amendment, Article 48A, 51AG, these two important provisions were added. Article 48A, it obligates upon the state to take measures for protection of environment and safeguarding forest and wildlife, etc. Likewise, Article 51AG imposes a duty on the Indian citizens to protect and improve the national environment, and also have compassion for the living creatures, and also for safeguarding the water, the forest and the wildlife. Now these two provisions are fundamental in nature, in the sense that these two provisions set goal to be followed, to be achieved by the state as well as the citizen of the country. And these two provisions cannot be enforced. And perhaps this is the reason that until 1987 judgment, by the Supreme Court, these two provisions were considered to be like showcase and I had no any such significant value. But in the year 1987, Supreme Court made an observation that these two provisions are not only the provisions under the Constitution, rather these two provisions can also be taken help to protect and improve the quality of environment. How? Because here the state is under obligation to protect and improve the quality of the environment, and therefore whenever the state plans any development plans, if it prepares any development plan, then the environment should get space in the such plans. Likewise, it is the individuals that they should mind their activities, they should mind their behavior, and they should live in society in such a manner and not to contaminate the environment, not to exploit the natural resources in such a way that it cannot be sustained anymore. Now, these two provisions were added to the Constitution, and these two provisions set a classic example for the world constitutions, because no other constitution has this kind of provisions. Further, by judicial interpretation, the Supreme Court of India has expanded the ambit and scope of Article 21, that is right to life of the persons, and this interpretation has given tremendous scope for the development of the law, for the development of the state activities, and also creating awareness among the people of India. Further, 73rd and 74th amendments were brought in, and by these amendments, here the local units like the Gram Panchayat and the municipal corporations have been recognized as important instrument to prepare schemes, plans, and particularly for the environment protection. Say, for example, the supply of the drinking water, forestry, cremation grounds, the tanneries, etc. Now, these schedule 11th and 12th were added, and these schedules do contain the subject matters pertaining to environment. So now there are three-tier system, one can say. One is at the parliament, at the central level, where parliament may enact the laws, then the state, and finally, or at the local level, it is the municipal corporation or the panchayats that may also take some steps. They may prepare the plan and they may contribute in protection and improvement of the environment. Now, coming to the legislations. The legislations have set a standard for the polluting materials, for the pollutants, and also for the environment. What should be the permissible limit? See that there is agency like the Pollution Control Board that gives consent to the different units or the different entities that may have some impact causing pollution of the environment. So the consent is to be given, and the Pollution Control Board does operate as a monitoring agency also, and it looks after the fact that the industries or the units they are complying with the conditions towards protection of the environment or towards minimizing the pollution of water, air, or even noise. So the problem is that despite of the fact that we do have several legislations, and also like the NGT, that the National Green Tribunal Act was passed in 2010, that is a comprehensive legislation providing for compensation to the victims, providing for the power of the tribunals to impose the compensation, rather to pass order so that the grievance could be properly redressed. And the very recent example of the tribunal's order, that the very recently in Vishakhapatnam there was leakage of the gas, and the tribunal has passed order awarding compensation to the victims, looking into account also the restoration of the environment. So these legislations are helping, no doubt, but the point is that the enforcement of the legislation, the laws have been passed, objectives have been set out, machinery has been installed, the powers, functions, duties, etc. have been clearly defined. The point is that do we have a satisfactory environmental condition? And this point cannot be answered in a very comfortable way, because we find that at the grassroots level, the standard of the polluting material is not diminishing. The resources are getting polluted day by day. And the best example is that now we say that the pollution load, as we assume that the pollution load is mainly caused by the industries, but the truth is that 80% pollution load is caused by the sewage, that is the municipal waste, and there around the 15 to 16% pollution is caused by industry, and the remaining 4% pollution is caused by the agriculture or the dairy, etc. Now, each and every industry, once it is established, it must seek consent from the pollution control board, and that industry has to comply with the conditions imposed by the pollution control board, and the law rather ordains the authority, that is the pollution control board officials, to keep on monitoring. Now, if we take the position of law, then we can presume that there is no pollution or pollution is under control. But unfortunately, it is not true, because see that there are industries, as per this was the question raised in the Rajya Sabha on 7/1/19, and regarding the question was regarding the industrial waste. And in reply to that question, it was placed before the House that there are 2,743 grossly polluting industries. And out of these industries, 2,222 are complying with the conditions. And then there are certain industries, about 74. Where the pollution control board has passed order for the closure, and then some instructions have been given to around 143 industries, and legal cases have been initiated against 3. Now, presuming that 2,222 industries, they are complying with the condition or imposed by the environment, the pollution control board, it means that if everything is under the control or they are complying with the condition, then the environmental pollution could have been controlled. But this COVID problem, which compelled the authorities to lock down all the activities, and particularly the industrial activities were completely shut down. Now, it is reported from the different corners that the river like Ganga and Yamuna look very pure, and now the fishes one can see from the surface, the aquatic plants are growing, the turbidity of water is less, there is velocity, there is purity in the river. Why? Because there is no industrial pollution. And also it is reported that now the air is very clear, and from some of the western district of Uttar Pradesh, one can see the Himalayan range. So this is the beauty of the nature, and it should have been the situation even when the industries were operating. Why? Because these industries were complying with the conditions. So it means that if the condition is compliant with, why the law has been passed? Law has been passed to lay down certain standards, certain permissible standards, and each and every authority which have rather unit that have undertaken some industrial activity must comply with the condition, means put limit on the trade effluence or emission of gases. So if it is done, then the law, of course, it is presumed that if the law has laid down certain standards and everyone is complying with, it means that pollution is under control. But the truth is that despite the complying conditions of the environment, the pollution of water was very, very serious, pollution of air was a serious matter. It means that either there is lack of the sensitivity towards environment, either there is no proper monitoring of the condition of the environment, or there is some kind of inappropriate monitoring of the conditions of the environment, the such units or such industrial units. Ultimately, if the condition of environment is better, so one can again fear that once the activities start, again the same condition will come. It means that the water is polluted, water is not fresh water, or it cannot be used for the normal or the ordinary purposes, and what the air is polluted. So just you see the gap, one can see the gap between the standard of law, the objective of the law, and the execution of the law, the enforcement of the law. If there is closure, then the environment is good. If the industrial activities are on, then the environment is bad or it is polluted. Then what's the use of these provisions? What's the use of the constitution of the authorities? And ultimately, perhaps the purpose of law gets defeated. Now, at this point, it is also important to point out that the first time in the year 1986, the Ganga Action Plan Phase 1 was initiated for the protection of the water of River Ganga, and in the year 1993, Yamuna and Gomti was added to it, and this Ganga Action Plan, it was given a new name in the year 1993 as the National River Conservation Plan, and out of this plan, National Mission for Clean Ganga was set up, of course, with the same objective. And again, in 2016, the Ganga Council Rejuvenation, Protection and Management Authority was set up, and the earlier authority, like the National Mission for Ganga, Clean Ganga, or the National River Conservation Plan, these were dissolved, and now we have this Ganga Council for Rejuvenation, Protection and Management since 2016. Now this authority is important in the sense that here under the Environment Protection Act 1986, the central government is empowered to constitute authorities for different purposes. The constitution of this authority is for very specific purpose, and the purpose is revealed by the name it is given to the authority. Now, since it is named as the Ganga Council Rejuvenation, Protection and Management Authority, so the title suggests that it will rejuvenate River Ganga, it will protect River Ganga, and it will also manage the situation or the pollution problem of River Ganga. So now the authorities have been created, and if you look at since 1986 up to 2016, so this comes around 30 years, and during this period of 30 years the authorities different name but with the same objective have been created, and thousands and thousands crores of rupees have been spent, but the effect was not as good as we find during this lockdown. So it means that there is some lapse or there is some inaction on the actual enforcement of the legal provisions. The permissible standards are not duly maintained, and this has given rise to a situation that we have to rethink, we have to reframe, and we have to re-energize our authorities so that the objectives of the law could be achieved. Now, one thing at this point, we should also, since the purpose of this Environment Day is to sensitize the people, to create awareness among the people, here the individual's obligation as laid down in the Constitution should be publicized. People should be taught about, their awareness should be created, and also the state should be reminded of its obligations. Now, state means here the state's officials, that they should also be reminded that it is the obligation of the state to protect the environment. The various other resources, it is not only the law that could control the increasing problem of pollution, rather the different religion, what I have seen in the different religious scriptures, that each and every religious scriptures have spoken about the protection of water, protection of air, and protection of environment as such. So it is also, and particularly in India, that is predominantly a religious country, and here the people belonging to all the religions are here, and therefore I feel that from that perspective the people should also be educated about the sin and the virtues, about their activities that ultimately affect the environment. I feel that simply passing of the law is not sufficient. The awareness, sensitization of the people, and the infrastructure, this is very important, that whether the implementing agencies, the enforcement agencies, have sufficient infrastructure or not. I think this is very important, and it is to be looked into whether there is sufficient staff, the sufficient skilled staff, they could examine the samples, they should also with the proper instrument, tools, chemicals, etc., so that they could examine the specimen in time, and also the report could be published. If there is consistent effort on this process, I think it would help a lot in creating an ambience for the proper scrutiny, proper monitoring, and also the steps to be taken so that the objectives could be achieved. Now, I may refer on the 7th of January 2019, the question was raised regarding the industrial pollution in the country. And in reply to that question, CPCB, as per the CPCB, that is the Central Pollution Control Report, it was pointed out that there are 2,743 grossly polluting industries in India, and out of this total of 2,743, 2,222 industries are duly complying with the conditions as laid down under the environmental legislations, and the other industries, particularly about 74 industries, were asked by the Pollution Control Board for the closure, and certain industries around 143, some instructions, directions were issued to take proper care. And it is rather sad to note that there are pending cases, only against three industries. Now, and it is said that the only the 37% of the waste, that is the sewage, are treated as of now. Now, it is a matter of great concern that the Ganga Action Plan was initiated and started in the year 1986, and in January 2019, it is reported to Rajya Sabha that only 37% sewage treatment plants, rather the capacity of the sewage treatment plant is only 37%. So, sincere efforts need to be made, and the objective of the for protection of the purity of river Ganga in particular and in general other rivers could be maintained, could be properly, rather it may be the water quality could be of proper use, kind of a signal they may also set up that if it continues, it would be the ultimate effect on the environment. And here, then we might land up in a situation where the reverse process is not possible. And with this observations, I think that it is important to think again to ourselves that the environment that provides us space to live in, it is the environment that maintains our livelihood, the environment that sustains our life, is the only environment, and there is no any alternative resource that we can depend upon ignoring the present environment. And I appreciate a beautiful couplet of poet where it is laid down that rather it has caused a kind of alarm, and we should be very, very sensitive, and the poet has tried to awake us that you should be very, very careful in your activities. When it is said that ab waqt aa gaya hai kainat ka socho wo root gayi gal to ye mauke na milenge jo ho raha hai samjho kyon ho raha hai kudrat ke badan ko aur kitna hi chhilenge mauka hai abhi dekh lo phir der na ho jaye jo kudrat ko diye zakh hum kaise silenge. So just to remind this thing that we should sustain our environment, we should think over the environment, and we should protect our environment. Thank you very much.
Thank you Mehdi sir for your informative and thought provoking lecture. Now I invite Dr. Raju Majhi for formal vote of thanks.
Very good evening to one and all. Once again, I welcome you all on behalf of Current Law Forum, Law School, Banaras Hindu University. I feel very privileged to extend my heartfelt thanks to our distinguished speaker of the day, Professor Ali Mehdi sir. He is a senior most professor of the faculty. He is one of the renowned teacher of environmental law, sir. We are very overwhelming by your thought-provoking lecture, sir. During your deliberations, you have discussed the various aspects of environmental law, sir. You have discussed various factors which pollute the environment, Sir, you have also bring out many important judicial pronouncements where the apex court of the country had issued very significant guidelines to curb down the environmental pollution. You have also highlighted the various aspects, various mechanisms available in national and global level. You have also touched the national and international instruments to control the environmental pollutions. Finally, you have bring the notice to that what happened in the present scenario, what happened during the lockdown period. And during the lockdown period, we have experienced that what kind of the environment we have experienced. Particularly if you'll see in respect of the air, water, and noise. We will find that there were no any kind of the noise pollutions. You will find that there were no any kind of the air pollutions. There were the air pollutions were come down. And particularly if you'll experience that the water, then that the people experience that the Ganga is going to be the very clean. So we really very much grateful to you for this wonderful deliberations. You have given your valuable time for this event, sir. Once again, we are very much thankful to you, sir. Now, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to Professor R.P. Rai, Head and Dean, Law School, Banaras Hindu University. Sir, it is your dynamic leadership that we are able to organize the many academic activities. It is your keen interest towards the academic activities. It is your encouragements that we are able to organize such kind of events. We are really very much grateful to you, sir, to extend all sorts of supports to organize such kind of events. Once again, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to you, sir. Now, I would like to express my sincere thanks to all the honorable members of the current law forums, Law School, Banaras Hindu University, all the distinguished faculty members of the faculty, all the respected viewers, all the respected guests, all the students. Without your valuable time, without your support, this event will not reach up to this success. So once again, I thank you all. I also express my thanks to Professor D.K. Mishra and Dr. Anoop Kumar for disseminating these events in a very in all the electronic press and social media. Thank you very much, sir. Now I would like to express my sincere thanks to Professor Dr. Rajnish Kumar Patel, that I would like to mention few words to him, that he is the sole architect of this program, that it is his keen interest to organize the such lecture series under the umbrella of Current Law Forums Law School, Banaras Hindu University. Sir, it is your great efforts, it is your sincere efforts to organize such kind of events. We extend thanks to you, sir. Finally, I express my heartfelt thanks to all those who have extend their valuable time and extend their support directly, indirectly, to make this event great success. Thank you very much. We will meet again in another series of lecture. Till then, take care of yourself. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.